The recording of this session. So today's topic would be on EC2. So we have completed in previous week about VPC. So today we'll be discussing about from next 3 to 4 days we'll be discussing about EC2. So EC2 architecture. So we'll see how the EC2 architecture is at least basics is designed and what is EC2. And let us understand the EC2 pricing as well. Then we'll see EC2 options from dashboard. So this is what we are going to see today. And so let's try to complete EC2, all the options. If something is pending, we'll try to see tomorrow and complete, okay? So let us discuss about EC2 architecture at first. So I have got this slide for that. So if you can see the diagram here, right? So this is how the EC2 architecture AWS has designed. So when you see this diagram, you can see, let me take. Just give me a sec. So when you see here, so the AWS has designed EC2 in such a way that, so these are your virtual machines or the EC2 instance. So now we are going on launching one EC2 instance of T2 Micro, right? Free-tier. So your EC2 mission will be launched here. So basically all, this is a host, a big host where you will have multiple CPUs. And so we are not sure how much CPU they are going to keep in one server or one host. That is what AWS will take care. So they are not going to tell us, and they will not even tell even if you ask. So they will have multiple CPUs, multiple RAMs, and we will have an instance store and EBS storage. So this we'll discuss what are instance stores on the EBS optimized storage or EBS Amazon. So for this server mission, so this is one server. Say for example, if you want to see the server, you can see here, just go to Google. So from who are the server suppliers like HP servers or Dell servers are there, right? So let us assume this is a server. Okay, so if you take this one, this is the server, what we have, let me open in. So if you see here, this is one server what we will have in our infrastructure background. So whenever you are trying to create EC2 instance, right, either it might be in GCP or it might be in Azure, Microsoft, or it might be in AWS as well. So when you create a EC2 instance in this server, the instances will be coming and launched here. So either it might be for VPC or it might be for different customers as well. So for example, HDFC has launched a EC2 mission. So that EC2 will come in the same server. It might come or may not come. So those settings we will see and discuss how different spot instances or different instance types are available. So basically this is the physical server. So these physical servers will be connected in the data center. If you have seen the first class, we have seen how data center will be there. So, in background, this is the architecture of that particular one server. So each server will contain CPU and RAM with a instance store or EBS storage. So the CPU or RAM are different. So how many virtual machines will come per server? That is depending on the server capacity based on the CPU and RAM. So they will give number of instances or virtual machines to the end users. So in the background, you will have a network connectivity to connect for internet. So we are going and coming and connecting to this internet and EC2 missions and S3 storage or EBS volumes. So EBS volume is nothing but your data, what you're going to store. Your user data will be there in EBS volumes when you're launching a server. So many of you asked me if you're going to stop the EC2 server, are you going to be charged? I told yes. Why? Because you are not going to, they are not going to charge you anything for the server, because when you are stopping, so this virtual machine they will allocate to someone, and whenever you are starting, they will create a new virtual machine and they give you with your user data. So they don't charge anything for your server when you stop the instance, but while creating server, you are selecting the storage, right? 8 GB storage of SSD or EVS volume. So for those 8 GB, they are going to charge you. That's the reason I said they will be charging you. So basically, when you stop the instance, there is no charge for EC2 instance, but for the storage, they are going to charge you. So that's the reason you need to terminate your instance. When you're going to terminate this EC2 instance, whatever the data used by the user or the software installed by user will be stored in either EBS. So those will be deleted and no charges will be applied. Clear? So in a high level, this is the EC2 architecture. Just keep this in mind, because you need to understand better when we're discussing about placement groups and EC2 store, EC2 instance stores. You need to understand how this background of each and every server will look like. Okay, basically any data center, it not either Azure or even the virtual data center, virtual machines in your organizations also will be having the same thing. So they will have a big server with a great capacity of CPU and RAM. So they will divide those. The hypervisor is nothing but a software which will divide your hardware into multiple VM machines. So in market, there are two hypervisors. One is VMware and Hyper-V. They are the best hypervisors, software providers. So VMware is from, I guess, Dell, and Hyper-V is from Microsoft. Okay. So what is EC2? So EC2 is nothing but, so they are renting, AWS is renting virtual machines. So this is nothing but EC2, what we launched these days. It might be a Linux machine, or it might be a Windows, or it might be any private operating system machines. Example, like RHEL or SUSE or Ubuntu, like this. So this is a renting virtual machine. So storing data on virtual drives. So store the data on virtual drives. So this might be an EBS drives or S3 or, instance store, everything. So that we'll be discussing in our further classes. And also EC2 will, basically, I'm telling not about only EC2 instance. I'm talking about EC2, complete EC2, which will be EC2 dashboard and services. If you see here, I'm talking about the complete one. Okay. So what is about EC2 all? So they provide, they distribute the load. Across the network, across the machines in a network, which is through ELB, right? ELB means Elastic Load Balancer. Okay. And also they provide scaling of your services. Through auto scaling groups, they call as ASGs. So these are the main services which are provided by EC2. So most of the things we will cover in EC2, means when we are checking about EC2, right? So till now, you know what is EC2, means you are launching only Linux server, but EC2 also provides Windows server, EC2 also provides Ubuntu and all. So, and also you need to understand how many instance types are there, launch templates, spot instances, and different options. So when you're launching EC2 instance, right? So you have around seven steps. So this many configurations, why Amazon is providing you when you're launching an instance. So you need to understand each and every step here. So we will see that today. Then storing the data in virtual drive. So here we have EBS, instant store, SSD, magnetic disks also is there, but we are not going to discuss about it. This we are not using anymore. They still provide options. So now they mostly we will use EBS or instant store or SSD. So this only these three type of data we are storing we are using. So we will discuss about these three. We have a different class on EBS and instant store. So we will skip this storage part when we are discussing about EC2. Okay. So then we have network load balancing. So when you have your application, right? So too much of traffic is coming to your databases or to your application servers. Now you need to distribute this data for different servers in order to maintain this the latency issues or in order to give better customer experience. So that time you are going to use this elastic load balancers or network load balancers. There are two types of load balancers in ELB. One is network load balancer and one is application load balancer. We will see both of them. And say, for example, you have T2 instances or M4 large instances. All of a sudden, your traffic is more and you need to, the CPU memory is getting occupied. So then you need to obviously, increase your storage or your memory of performance of your system. So we will use auto scaling for this. So we will also see what is auto scaling groups and launch configurations. Okay. So this is what we're going to see in EC2, and let us understand the pricing of EC2, how EC2 is getting price. So in EC2, they provide renting based on hourly, hourly basis. So for example, minimum, they will charge you for 60 seconds. So even if you launch a mission and if you terminate before 60 seconds, so at least you will take 60 seconds to, launch the instance and delete it. So even if you try to kill the instance before 60 seconds, either through AWS CLI command lines or other things, so you will be charged for minimum of 60 seconds. So now let us understand how this will be there. So this charging will be there based on either what is the instance type you're selecting. It is T2 or M4 or C5 or based on the instance GPU or CPU loaded ones, based on that instance type and also the region. Say for example, if you select a mission in North Virginia region or if you select a mission in Mumbai region, there will be a cost difference. So, and also, there are different type of on-demand, spot, reserved, and dedicated host. So this we will see while we're discussing about EC2 options. Now, also, it depends on operating system. Say, for example, if you are using Linux or Windows or any private operating system, some private operating systems, they charge for their operating systems also during this one. So what type of operating system you are using and is it a spot or reserved instance or on-demand instance? On-demand instance is nothing but the instances what we are launching till now in our lab, right? Directly you go select an instance and launch it, which is you got a demand to use the mission, so you are launching it. So that's the on-demand mission. Spot and the reserved instances, we'll discuss it later. Then instance type. So based on the type you select, you will get the CPU and the memory one. So based on the instance type and the region. So these are the four major parameters where EC2 instance prices will be varied. Okay. So you will be billed by the second within minimum of six. So whenever you launch EC2 mission, the billing will start. So minimum of 60 seconds will be launched. So you'll also pay for other factors such as storage, data, and okay. So the pricing, whatever they are showing here for EC2, right? So that is only for your EC2 mission. On top of that, if you are taking SSD storage or EBS volume of 100 GB or 500 GB, that storage cost will be different. And also if you take some fixed public elastic IPs or load balancing things, so those components and services price will be varied accordingly. So as I told, you no need to pay for your instance if the instance is stopped. Only you need to pay for the user data, what you're going to store it on EBS or S3 when the instance is stopped. Okay. Let us see one simple example, how it is charged, right? So for example, if you use the machine only for 6 seconds, and if you are using T2 small machine in US East 1, Virginia, and the cost is $0.023 per hour. This is hourly cost. Whatever they are showing is hourly cost. So how it will come in AWS billing dashboard or the cost in your actual billing is. So if you launch for a machine for 6 seconds, which is less than a minute, right? So they will still charge you for 60 seconds because the minimum charge is done for 60 seconds. So 0.023 divided by 60. So this is the cost which you are going to come. So for 60 seconds also, same cost will be there. Now, say for example, you use a machine, this machine for half an hour. Then the total cost is per hour, right? Divided by 2, which is $0.0115 is the cost for 30 minutes. Like this, suppose if you are using this for 1 month, then per day 24 hours, and per month, let's assume 30 days, then it is total $16.56 for a T2 small in Virginia, US East, North Virginia region. Questions? So you have different EC2 pricing options. Now let us not see this slide. We will discuss it after discussing about reserved spot and on-demand instances. Now let us see to launch Windows machine. So launch instance, click on launch instance. So you see here different type of operating system, right? When you're here, so choose an Amazon, AMI is nothing but Amazon machine image. So you will have a different type of machines here. So multiple operating systems are there. So if you see here, this is a quick start. So then you have different option. My AMI is there, and AWS Marketplace is there, Community AMS is there, Fitter is there. Now, first let us see how to launch Windows machine. Then we will come back again to discuss about these options. So if you are not aware about Windows server, right? So Windows server is nothing but you will have a similar user interface of Windows 10 or Windows 7 or Windows XP or Vista. Similar user interface you will have for server, but that operating system is specially designed only to have to be installed on server machines. So you have different type of versions there again in Windows Server, like 2019 base with containers. So containers is nothing but you will have, you know, some already virtualization softwares installed inside this particular server. So you can directly use this server for your container applications. Then, so you have like, so these are the different type of, you know, operating systems which are provided by AWS. Now, so if you see here, there are huge variety of Windows softwares, sorry, Windows operating systems. Now let us select one basic Microsoft Windows Server 2019 base. So if you see here, this is free tier eligible. So if you select some other machine, right? So for example, Windows Server 2019 with SQL Server 2017 standard. So this is not a free tier. So when you're trying to launch this one, and if you go and check here under the family type, so you will not have any free tier eligibility here because they already mentioned it is not under free tier eligible. So whatever free tier eligible shows here, only that machine you will be able to launch for free in our free tier account. Okay. Now let us launch one server 2019 base operating system. Yes. So you can see here, similar to Linux, you have T2 micro free tier eligible. Even if you launch for this machine, it is 750 hours per month, which you get for free. But just remember one thing, Windows machines will be pretty slow when compared to Linux servers. Till now, you launch Linux servers, right? Immediately after launching, within 10 to 15 seconds of time, you will be able to connect with PuTTY and do your own work with your Linux server. But Windows server will take minimum of 4 minutes to launch. That too, if you are taking T2 micro type of instances, it will take still more time to launch. So for our lab to continue quickly, I'll take T2 small, so it'll be a bit quicker. For your lab, if you want to try, you can try T2 micro as well. Okay, so it'll take some time. That's why I'm trying to avoid that. So take T2 small, go to configure instance. So here you know all this, selecting a VPC. I'm selecting August 1st. And I'm selecting in public subnet, and I want external IP address. So these options are all same. So let me assign one private IP, 10.1.1.1. So if you see here, for Linux, you are getting around 8 GB of EBS or SSD. But if you see Windows, by default, it is 30. If you try to reduce, I guess it won't accept, okay. So by default 30 is there. If you select this 30, the billing will be same, even though if you reduce this 20 GB, right? So they don't reduce in billing. So that is what my understanding is. So that's explicitly mentioned. You can refer to the document here. You have a URL here, EC2 instances.info. Instances, yeah. So here you have a huge variety of instances. So here you can verify what is the charge they are going to do. So cost, you can select your cost. So for example, if you wanted to do monthly cost, then you can select how much cost will be there for monthly. So type, you can select here which type. So we are using T2, right? So T2. We are using small. So monthly it is around $16.7. Okay. So like this, you can select, I will ping this URL in the chart. You can save this one. So click on next. So tags. So as I told, tag, we can do the name tags. So tags has very important role. So we will discuss that options. So security group is same, like how you select for Linux, right? Same security group you're going to select here. Then click on launch. So while launching for Windows, we are, let us select August 1st key pair. So this is the key pair which we are regularly using. So launch instance. So for Windows machine, we are not going to log in with PuTTY, right? So then why, what is the need for key pair? This is a private key. So what is the need for the key pair to generate? So we'll see it now. So if you see here, so we got all the public IP or private IP. So when you try to connect, see the connect is still disabled here. So it will take approximately 3 to 4 minutes of time in order to make this Windows machine up. That too, we are using t2.small. So it will be a bit quicker. So the machine is running. So when you say click on connect, so you can see here connection method, either you can do it through a session manager. So if you want to do through session manager, you should be already logged into the machine and install the session manager inside a machine. So that, since we are accessing this machine for the first time, we cannot use session manager. So go to a standalone RDP client. So here you can see download remote desktop file. So click on download. So you'll get a downloaded file and you have the public DNS name or the username here and password. So to get this password, click on get password. So if you see here, it shows a message, right? Please wait at least 4 minutes after launching an instance before trying to retrieve the auto-generated password. So we should be waiting for at least 4 minutes to generate. So meanwhile, we'll see the other options. Connect. So either you can connect to through the downloaded file. This is RDP file which got downloaded. either to connect like this, or you can directly open command prompt and type mstse. So once you type mstse, then you can use a public DNS. This is the mission name what you see here. So you can copy this mission name and provide it here. So then it will ask you for the username and password. Username is nothing but administrator connect. So password, we need to generate the password. So to generate the password, So if you see here, now the system is up. So it is asking here for the key pair. So key pair path means if you provide the key pair, the private key, what we generated during our in the key pairs, if you provide this key pair here and decrypt the password, you will get your password here. So this is your decrypted password for that particular Windows server to log in. Now provide the password here and click on OK. So this will just say yes. This will open your Windows machine as a server from your local. See, for this, just remember one thing. Now, since we are launching this mission in our public subnet, you are using through external internet. Now, for example, if you're launching the Windows server in private, right? Then how do you connect? You can use your private IP to connect. So you can use this private IP to connect, but you should have the connectivity for this private IP, okay? So this is your Windows mission. So if you see here, the Windows machine is launched. So you can, it's like pretty much similar to your desktop, what you have here, what we're using. So see, I recommend, see Windows, most of the people know how to use this Windows server and Windows machine, right? So that's why I prefer everyone to learn Linux and work with Linux operating systems only. And I mean like Linux distributions. So questions here? So any doubts how to launch this, you know, Windows?
As we can actually launch Windows machine as well, and we can access this without PuTTY. So yeah. Using this Windows machine, can we use it actually to just work as our lab only? Means we can use it for our labs as well?
Yeah. See, you can use Windows machine for your lab as well. So that's not at all a problem.
Because the way that we were trying to actually do the PuTTY and all, installing the PuTTY on our system. So in that way, we can install the PuTTY on this Windows as well.
First understand one thing. So PuTTY is a tool which is used to connect to your Linux server, Linux machine. So to connect with your Windows, you are in a Windows operating system. So to connect with that, you need use MSTSC.
Yes.
So remote desktop connection. Open the remote desktop connection. Then you can give the computer name. So this, either you can give the computer name here, or you can give the public IP address. So if you give the public IP address here, and you can try with this as well. Let me close this server here.
Okay.
So let us try with public IP now. So username is administrator. And password you can see here. Give the password. It's very simple to connect with your Windows machine. So later on.
That part I got, Harish. The doubt I was asking that because in my current machine, I was not able to actually install PuTTY and all and run from it because of other VPN connections.
Yeah.
So I was just checking that, okay, just to learn is.
See, yeah, you understood.
That Linux machine connection, yeah, but having this machine instead of my machine, and then in this machine, can I actually have the PuTTY?
Yes, Alesh. See, if you are, you are using a free tier account, but it will be chargeable, right? So if you are ready to, bear the cost of this mission, so definitely you can do that. So, but it is cost is involved here, right? So this is unnecessary, this additional layer of this one. So you better sort out your either through your Mac or through your local Windows machine.
Okay.
So any other questions? So let us terminate this one because I launched T2 small, so it will be chargeable. So if you see here, so we have other options here. So if you go for instances, launch instance. So we have quick start. Under quick start, we have different operating systems like Linux, Red Hat, then you have Ubuntu, then Windows and all. So if you come to My AMS, so AMS is nothing but Amazon Machine Image. So you can create your own image. Say for example, you're launching a Linux server. In that Linux server, you're installing Java 8 and Tomcat server, and you're having your own application. Okay. So next time again, when you try to launch the, you will terminate the mission after your use. Again, if you want to try to launch, again, you need to install Java, you need to install Tomcat, you need to install your application. So these, all these are repetitive tasks, right? So what you can do is, we can create your own image. So on top, whenever you launch this, your image, so currently I have removed all the images. So if, whenever you try to launch that image, automatically those softwares will be pre-installed for you and your user data will be available in those AMIs. So that is My AMIs option. And you have AWS Marketplace. So here, so we have seen security groups and network SLs, right? So those are the firewalls which we are using in our VPC, we have seen. So if you want to use a private firewall, so if you you can, you say, I don't want to use, you know, security groups and network SLs, I want more security and other things, you can go with the private vendors like Barcode Networks, then Juniper, Cisco also will be available here. So all these are again chargeable. So let us see how they charge. So they charge hourly basis as well as the instance base. So for example, if you are going with the Barcode Network, right? So Barcode firewall. So if you're launching a T3.small instance, so $1.1 will be your software cost per hour. And EC2 instance cost will be $0.021. So total per hour, you need to pay $1.12 per hour if you're going with Barcode firewall for AWS. So software cost is different and EC2 cost will be same. So this is with the private, you know, firewalls. And if you go for community APIs, so these are the APIs, you know, which are developed by freelancers or the other communities which are there. So mostly these are not secure. So if you go with the AWS Marketplace, right? So these are the secure vendors which they are providing. Whereas if you go to community APIs, they provide still the same thing, but they're not that authorized or, you know, legitimate. And so you can filter out the operating system wise or architecture wise or the storage type, either you want to UBS or only instance storage types here using this filter. So now let us come to quick start. So most of the time, 90% of the time, you will be spending your time here only. You will have in your organizations, you will always go not create a Linux machine manually. You will be having already an AMI, you will go and launch that AMI. Say for example, you're a Java developer. What all the tools you are going to use in your day-to-day life, right? So you need to have your Eclipse or IntelliJ IDE, which is required to do coding. And you need the Tomcat server, you need MySQL or Oracle server database, and you need some code scanning tools like SonarQube or other tools like Maven, Git and all. So what the architect will do, so he will give a design such a way that the developer's AMI will be designed and it will be kept here. So whenever a developer will come, so he will launch that AMI and he will go and use the instance on the ready to go way. So the time will be saved, right? So if you launch an instance, this hourly billing based. So when you are trying to set up all this in setup, it will take around 4 or 5 hours for a developer. So this 4 or 5 hours of billing will be saved using this My AMI. So we will see how to create this My AMI tomorrow class. So most of the time you'll be spending here or in the quick start. So marketplace and community API. Marketplace, only few vendors we are going to use because this too costly, and only for the high security purposes clients will go there. So when you come to quick start, so you have different operating systems here, right? For every operating system what is shown in the screen, you will have an AMI, unique AMI. So if you see here for Amazon Linux AMI 2018.3 HVM, the AMI is this one. This is the AMI ID. Okay, this is region specific. So just pay attention. So this is region specific. So the AMI what you are seeing here. So for example, the same. Let me go to. Let me copy this one. So this is the AMI for our. So if you go to a different region, right? So if you go to Ohio, now let me go to North Virginia. So you have the same mission here. If you see the AMI ID here. So the MID is changed here, you know, but the mission instance type is same. So this is how AWS is giving. So every mission image, whatever they provide, is having a unique AMI, and that is region specific.
So Harish, this AMI is used when you're spinning machines up in command line. That's the purpose.
Yeah, so for those purpose they will use, and also while doing the cloud formation, right, in the scripts they will say, see, this is unique. If you launch 100 instances also, for 100 instances this AMI ID will be same. So to select the type of instance, they will use this AMI in the scripting.
And what's the next ID? Is that's a different machine, which is 64-bit ARM.
Yeah, so this for 86-bit. This, if you don't see here.
Bit.
Yeah, 64.
Yeah, it's like the two options in the side. Okay. Yeah, it's the radio button on the side. Yeah. Okay.
The 64-bit ARM, yeah.
64-bit ARM. Correct. Well, this is a type, and there are two radio buttons for that machine.
Yeah. Oh. So usually when you launch the instances, right? See here, you are launching manually because we are in status for AWS. So the experts and the real-time project mates. So we never come to the console to launch a EC2 mission. So what we do is we will have a JSON file. So where we'll be having a complete configuration. So what is my VPC? What is my subnets? What is my routables? What is my security groups? And also here I will come my EC2 configuration. In my EC2 configuration, I will give you here my AMI ID. So the type, what is the image type? So I'll give my AMI ID. So this, that time I will use this AMI. So I will have a, you can refer this in AWS document for which type of operating system, what AMI will be there. So say for example, if I want Amazon Linux AMI, I'll use this AMI ID in my JSON so that whenever I execute, so automatically all the VPCs, subnets, routables, everything and EC2 missions will be spinned up, and inside this EC2 missions, all the required softwares also will be spinned up with a single button click and code. So this is cloud formation we have on different dedicated class. We'll see in that, okay. So this AMI is region specific. So in interview, they will ask these questions just to check your AWS knowledge, working experience. So just in keep in mind, so the question would be like, say he will tell with the same AMI ID, I want to launch one instance in Sydney region, one instance in APAC Mumbai, and one instance in Ohio region. So you tell it is not possible. AMI is a region specific. It's not an it is linked to the operating system, either whatever the operating system they're giving, but it is region specific. Every region will have a unique AMI for that particular operating system. Okay. So and when you're doing the lab, right, till now it's fine. Either you select this AMI or you select this Amazon operating systems in Linux, fine. Or you select Red Hat also, it's fine. Because till now we were searching only for what are subnets, launching a private subnets, and we are launching NAT gateways, internet gateways, and checking the connectivity between two systems, right? So at max, what we were doing, the pinging or we were doing the SSH. So that you can do in any bare Linux operating systems as well. But hereafter, we'll be doing some lab like, installing Tomcat servers or Java softwares, right? So this, try to always select this Amazon machine AMI type. So this 2018.03, it will be always have Docker's, PHP, MySQL, Postgres, and also you will have the tools like Python, Ruby, Perl, and Java already installed in this one. So you will not waste much time to install new other softwares. Already these packages will be there. You just need to enable these packages. You don't need to go and install it from the scratch on like a bare Linux machines. Clear? Okay, let's select this. Let's select this one. Now you see, while launching the instance type, so you need to choose an instance type, right? So there are various instance types here. So how do you choose? As an architect, you must be able to tell, right? So these are the machines what you need to use. These are the machines which are required for this configuration. Based on your application, you need to tell what type of CPU and what memory is required, what is the instance storage gigabytes you need to provide for that particular instance. So in order to do that, you must understand how many instance types are classified by AWS. So if you click on the drop-down, you can see general purpose, compute optimize, GPU. GPU is nothing but graphical processing instances, memory optimized instances, and storage optimized instances. Earlier, there were still more like GPU graphics were there, GPU compute was there, memory optimized were there. So now they removed a few of them and classified as same. So if you see here, all instances are nothing but they will list all the instances. When you come to general purpose instance, right? So these are used for our lab. So for our lab and small applications, so these general purposes is used. So when you go to compute optimize, right? So compute optimize, who is going to use this? When you require more CPU usage, so then you are going to use compute optimize. So GPU instances are like, so GPU and GPU compute, we should be there. So GPU is like when you're writing a machine learning programs or artificial intelligence programs, which require more computing techniques, then we are going to use graphical processing units like gaming and other things. So we are going for GPU. Then memory optimized means whenever there is a lot of memory is required, right? So for example, SAP HANA. So this is a database, huge type of database. So if you want to run SAP HANA, you need a minimum hardware, maximum of memory, or like 4 TB RAM is minimum. Okay, so I'm not talking about storage. I'm talking about the RAM. It is 4 TB of RAM. So those type of use cases, you're going to use memory optimize. And storage optimize, you will use for better performance. So if you want better performance when you have a lot of storage, so then you're going for storage type of machines. Okay, so I have a URL here. So instance types. So this URL will tell you when to use. Let me open that and show you here. So if you see here, so these are the instance types available. T3 and T3A, T2, M6, M5, MA. So these are the different instance types. So and you can see here, the bandwidth, how much they provide, network bandwidth, how much they provide, and instance store, how much they provide. Okay. So those are the instance types. So the generation means, current generation means which are more commonly used now. If you select all generations, old CPU types also will be available. So to differentiate that, how you can do is, so for example, select any machine for, let's select T2 micro only. So when you select T2 micro, you can see here, current selected is T2 micro. And these are the configuration of that machine. Let me copy this to Notepad. So T2 micro, this one. So now let me go to M4, which is greater than T2, like M5.MDA.AD.XLarge. So if you go and see here, copy the CPU, data here. The instance type is M5.AD.XLarge. Okay. See, M5.AD.XLarge. So if you see here, CPU, how many CPUs you are getting in T2? You are getting only one CPU. Here you are getting two CPUs. And what you need to see here is the processor here. So the processor, if you see Intel Xeon family, but here if you see here, AMD EPY CPU, which is advanced processor of this one, where the processing will be too efficient and faster in M5.AD.XLarge when compared to T2 micro. So that's how you need to verify. So let's say your application requires let's assume only 10 users will log in per day. Doesn't matter if you use T2 micro or T2 nano also, because you don't need much performance. Only 10 users will log in. They'll just do some small steps and they log out. So when you assume if you have around 100 users hitting every hour your server, then you need a performance, better performance CPU. And this one, this is how you can differentiate this one. So even storage, you can see here. While choosing the machine, right? So basically you will not you will not decide how to choose. So you will have a brainstorming sessions with multiple application owners and product owners, and you will have with stakeholders. Then you will decide after a few meetings, then you will decide what type of instance you need to use. So this will be, so suppose if you're an architect, you need to do the job. Or if you're a developer, your architect will tell, boss, this is the instance what you need to launch. So go and select this particular instance type, and this is the EBS storage you need to attach. So your job will be simple if you're a developer. So that's how this will be calculated and done. So then you have other options like here. You can see this is number of CPUs. So at max, you will have around 15 CPUs also I have seen. So 16, yeah. So if you see here, C6.XLarge, compute optimized machines. You can see few of them are disabled here, right? Why? Because you are in a free tier account. So in order to launch this one, so this is, if you see the costing for this, it is too high when compared to normal. So the costing is $0.12. So normal T2 micro and all $0.0216. So this and all the costing will be high. So if you want to enable this one, so either you can get in touch with support if you want for the same account, or you need to select your account not as a free tier account. Okay. Then
Harish, heard out actually.
Yeah. So
there is a when in the types actually there is a T series, M series.
Yeah.
Like R series, C series. Any significance for that? Because in every type again, medium, large, nano, yeah, micro, and all.
Yeah. See, T2 means we don't know why they kept T2 AWS. So that's a naming convention. So medium is nothing but, so that's how you need to, that's why I told, right? So when you select T2, right? So you need to see what type of CPU they are using here. So Intel Broadwell, right? So it is for T2 medium. So select now T2 large. So here the CPUs are two CPUs. So let me copy this one. So here it will change the CPU and the type of processing and the speed will be changed here. So let us copy this t2.launch. So if you see here, T2 large has two CPUs, 2.3 gigahertz, same processor you have, but the memory is, in T2 large it is 8 GB, but in T2 medium it is 4 GB of RAM. EBS anyways, yeah, you can increase as per your requirement, but if you see here, the memory has been increased. So if you go for X large, here 16 GB memory will be there, or sometimes the processor also will get changed. So if you go to different, right? So for example, if you go to M series, so for example, M4.large. So M4.large has two CPUs and Intel Xeon. The processor has been changed here. And also the memory has been 8 GB. So even here the memory is 8 GB and here also the memory is 8 GB. But the variation will be there in the processor. Whatever the processor is configured here, there that will be the variation. Clear? And network optimization, so you can see here low to high, and you can see up to 5 gigahertz high performance, up to 10 gigahertz what is the network throughput here. And IPv6, almost all will be supported with IPv6 here. Okay, now let's go and select our free tier one. So configure instance details. So here you can see one number as one, right? So up to 20 instances you can launch in a availability zone. So if you want to see the limit here, so you can just go to EC2 dashboard. You have option here, limits, right? So in the sidebar, just give me a sec. So click on the limits. So here you can see what are the limits here. So for everything they will provide here. Auto scaling, they provide dedicated host. If you go to second one, third one. So you can see here EBS volume, general purpose limits. Like this, you will have a limit here. So at max, even VPCs also they will specify. So if you see here, number of security groups per VPC per region. So around 2,500 you can create. And subnets per VPC. I told this in first class, I guess, 200. VPC security group per elastic network is 5. Means one elastic network load balancer. Means one for one EC2 instance, you can allocate up to 5 security groups. And also security groups, reserved instances. So this one, up to 20 instances you can do. So this here you can check the limit. So spend some time here to check whatever the doubts you have. So up to 20 you can launch. Now let us select one. And purchase option, request spot instances. So you will have different option here. So let us see this option later when we are discussing about spot instance and dedicated instance and dedicated hosts. Okay. So this you already know, select a VPC. What if you don't have VPC, you can create a VPC dynamically and select a subnet zone. So let us select public. And this also, you know, assigning a private IP, sorry, public IP. And placement group is something, right? So for example, if you select a placement group, so what exactly AWS will do is, so this is a server, right? So let me take one more notepad, sorry, paint. So let us take this as our VPC, okay? So inside data center, like Ohio region this is. So this is one availability zone, and this is the second availability zone, and this is the third availability, because Ohio has three, right? So let us name this as Ohio, zone A, zone B, and zone C. Okay. So let's say you launched an EC2 instance here. Okay, so this is your EC2 machine. This is your machine. So like this, this is your application. To run your application, you need three machines. One is for web server, app server, and this one. So the same replica you'll keep in availability zone also, available zone 2 and zone 3 as well. So now total for your application, how many servers you have? Let's assume 9 servers you have for your application. So what placement groups means? In placement groups, there are three types. One is cluster. Second one is spread, and third one is partition. Okay. So what happens in exactly in a cluster is, so whenever you launch a EC2 machine, right? So they make sure that all the EC2 machines will be under same cluster. I mean, when you create a cluster option, so if you launch EC2 machine under this particular availability zone, they'll try to launch this under same cluster so that the network connectivity will be more and throughput will be high. So that's the reason they this placement groups has been introduced. I guess this is introduced last year only. Before that, this placement group option was not there in EC2. So just to increase the latency, to reduce the latency and increase the throughput of accessing to different servers, this placement groups has been there. So there are three types. One is cluster, one is spread, and one is a partition. Let's see the difference between three of them. So before that, let me take one more paint here. So for example, this is your data center. Okay, so we know, we have seen the data center, right, in the first class. So this data center, now in this data center you will have different racks. Okay, so you will have a rack here, then you will have a rack, then you will have a rack like this. Like, so you will have different racks. Okay, so for this rack you will have a switch called TOR switch, which is top of the rack switch. Okay, so in each rack you will have a physical server. So this is your physical server. So when you launch a EC2 machine, right, what will happen? So your EC2 machine will come and get launched here. So if you launch one more EC2 machine, it will come and launch here. So this is in one availability zone, right? So like this, you have different availability zones. So let's assume this is an availability zone. So these two racks, and this is in these two racks in availability zone B. Now let's assume when you are launching one more EC2 machine, your mission will come here. Now what is the advantage of placement group is, right? So when you create a cluster, right, you can create a cluster inside your own availability zone, so that all your instances what you are launching, means you are a customer with your account, if any EC2 instance request is coming, so those instances will be launched side by side. By this, what will happen? So this is the actual network which is connected, right? Suppose if your DB server is here and if your application server is here, suppose if your application server want to communicate with DB server, so it should come to this, then the communication should go and it will go like this. So the throughput might be varied, right? So what customers will do is, the customers will try to keep their instances in a closed group. So that is called placement groups. So as I told, there are three types of placement groups, right? Cluster, spread, and partition. So I have this slides here. So let's go through quickly this theoretical slides. I just don't want to spend time on writing notepad. So as I told, right, sometimes you want to control over the EC2 in placement group strategy, because to increase your performance. Cluster is nothing but cluster instances into a low latency group and single availability zones. So this is how a customer is there. Means you cannot create a cluster like this. So for example, Let's go to this one. So this is in zone A, right? Zone B, right? Zone C. So you want this server, and this server. If you want to create a cluster like this, it is not possible. So cluster can be done only inside this availability zone. Okay. And when you come to spreads, right? Spread instances across underlying hardwares. Okay. So instance spread means, say they will ensure that when you launch through in a spread mode, your instance will be getting launched in the particular availability zone, and also this will be the only up to seven instances you can launch per availability zone under the spread. So spread is like you can keep like this, three here and one here. So this is how it will be there, but in one availability zone only seven, here only seven, and here also only seven, like this. Suppose if you are spreading across three availability zones, a total 21 instances you can create in spread. Question? See, this is practically you might not use this one, but you will get a question in while doing your certification exam. So just try to understand this one. And go ahead.
Can I move images from one zone to the other zone?
The AMI images what you created.
Yeah.
So AMI images is specific to account, Guru. So once you create your AMI image, right? So you can launch that in any zone. So while launching this AMI image, you will get an option here, either to select in zone one or zone two or zone three. So you can select during your launch. So cluster is within the same availability zone. Spread is, even though you create spread per availability zone, only seven instances limit will be there. And whereas partition is, so it spreads across multiple as many different partitions, but which rely on a different size of racks in different availability zones. Group. Okay. So same for this as well. I have an image here. Yeah. So this is the best image is there. So if you see here, so in the same rack, in one availability zone only, all these instances should be there. Okay. So the advantage of this one is bandwidth will be too high because all the instances will be side by side, right? So they can communicate with each other very quickly. So the fast will be two more. And what are the limitations here? Let's assume this rack got failed. So this is the top of the racks, which, right? So for example, due to some technical limitations, this rack got failed. All the physical servers which are there in the cluster will go down. So then your application will obviously go some outage. Where are the use cases we are going to use this big data job, where you need to say, for example, you need to transfer 200 terabytes of data from this machine to this machine. Then there is no sense if you go and keep in a separate availability zone and separate cluster. So then network latency will be high, right? So you'll keep side by side. And so for those use cases, you're using this placement groups cluster model. And second, so in the spread model, so what exactly spread does is, like, you know, just give me a sec. So in the spread model, what exactly happens is, like, you know, So you have your availability zone one here, zone two here, and zone three here. So you have your server here, so which is hardware, and you launch your EC2 machine here. So you can span across your availability zones, means you can create one EC2 in A, B, and C. But so what is the advantage of this one? In the previous cluster model, if in this zone, if the rack is failed, then you can you lose network load balancer and auto scaling, right? Automatically the traffic we can redirect to this one, so the application will not have any downtime. Okay, so that's one advantage. Then EC2 instances are in a different physical hardware, means say for example if there is any hardware issue in this particular hardware, because you will have a different EC2 machines in different hardware, right? So those are the advantages of spread one. And also the advantages is the limitations is only up to 7 instances you can launch per availability zone in a placement group. So for example, you created a spread group inside this one, so only 7 machines you can launch. So for example, you need minimum of 15 machines. So for example, multi-tenant clients, right? So in those situations, when you want to break out multi-tenant and make all the multi-tenant clients into a single tenant, if you have 20 clients, right, then you need 20 EC2 servers. You cannot create 20 EC2 servers in spread machines. So that's where the limitation is. And what are the exact use cases for this one is application that needs maximum high availability. So for example, if this got failed, you can launch here. If this got failed, you can launch here. If this got failed, by the time the second instance will be recorded in high availability. Clear? So the other placement group is partition. So in partition, what exactly happens is in single availability zone, you can do multiple partitions. So what is the advantage of this one is up to 7 partitions you can do. So here we have three partitions in single availability zone. And like that, you can do up to 7 partitions per availability zone. But if you see in spread, right, earlier one, in one spread, you can keep only 7 instances in availability. This is instances, but these are partitions. So these are partitions per availability zone. In spread, it is 7 instances. Clear? So see, these are the only main important things which you need to remember about placement groups. That's why I collated these points as a slide. So now how many instances you can launch? Now, if you see our earlier application, we had a limitation to launch only 7 applications, right? 7 instances. So here that problem will be solved in partition. Up to hundreds of EC2 machines you can launch across these 7 partitions, okay? If you want more, still you can request more. They'll be accommodating all those requests through AWS support. Now, what exactly will happen when you do partitions here, right? So this is in one availability zone. So when you do this partition, so let's assume this is one partition one. So this partition will be not shared with any rack. So for example, as I told, right? So this is one rack. So when you do partition, the partition will be only in this particular rack. So this partition will not spread to this rack, so that whenever this rack is failed, only these servers will get failed. So you can use the backup servers. So that is an advantage. Or also that's an also disadvantage, because if you keep all your 100 servers inside the same thing, all the 100 servers might go down, right? So you need to ensure that you keep application servers here and here as well. And you keep web servers here and here. And database servers, database actually you don't keep like this. You will create an RDS. So RDS will also have in multiple AZ zones. So you connect all this application web servers to RDS. So that's how you do RDS. But for now, quick understanding, so make sure that you have the databases like this. And so what are the use cases means? Like I said, right, when you want to use for Cassandra or Kafka, you can transfer this data from messaging systems. So those are the exact use cases. So that's all about placement groups. So how do you create placement groups? So that's the question now. So for that, you can see here. You have option here. Otherwise, you can go to EC2 console. You have option in the left hand side. Placement group. So here you can come, create a placement group. So let's give here the placement group like cluster based applications. Strategy, you see, if you see under strategy, now we will let us create cluster first, spread first, and partition second. So click on cluster and create a placement. So the placement group is created for cluster. Similarly, let us create for spread. And let's create for partition. Okay, so this you can see here while creating here. So go to the placement group. Let us come to instance. Add a placement group. So here you can see add to existence group. So you can see two. Okay, partition is there, spread is there. So okay, why? Because the cluster is not visible here. Any idea why? So because the instance type what you selected is very low instance, like t2.micro. Let us select someone which is big, like md5.xlarge. Yes, next. So if you go to placement group, so you can see cluster here. So here what we can type is AWS ENI. See, if you want to study about anything, right? Example placement group, just type AWS placement group and type the use case. So they will exactly give the use case. So not only for placement groups, security groups or anything, whatever you want to study, just type AWS, then give the topic name or service name and type the use case. Okay. So clusters are used. If you see here, only these are the things which are supported under cluster. So t2.micro is not at all here. So that's the reason it was not showing us. So only these EC2 types of instances will be available in cluster. Okay. Let us go back. Yeah, let us go and select our t2micro. Yeah. So that's all about placement groups, and you can select any placement group. So for now, I'll remove those. And capacity reservation is like for your EC2 instance. Say for example, if want to launch a EC2 instance capacity reservation, you need to match attributes like So instance type, platform, and availability zone for availability capacity. So even I have not used this one. So my understanding for this capacity reservation is, so you will reserve your EC2 instance by a target group or a target ID. So this we can check while we are doing for ASG, auto scaling groups. And IAM roles, we will discuss later. We will have it in different class for IAM. So don't worry about IAM now. And shutdown behavior. So by default, do you need to stop or terminate? So for now, if you type shutdown in the command, so it will stop. So you can select either to stop or terminate. And so this one, Hibernate stops your instance and save the contents of instance and RAM to the root volume. So whenever you stop the instance, right? So your data will be saved to your root volume. And this option is there, right? So enable terminate protection. So for example, by mistake, you have around 15-20 machines which you are managing in your UAT network or QA network. So all of a sudden you want to terminate an instance which you don't want to use anymore. So if you suddenly go and terminate an inappropriate machine or a different machine, then it's a huge loss, right? So that's the reason we will enable this one, protect against accidental terminations. So these are self-explanatory. You can go ahead. So now when you are going to terminate, right? Right-click on terminate instance. So you cannot easily delete. So you need to come, disable this one, then you need to go and delete. So when you're disabling, at least you'll monitor, right? What type of instance you're terminating, are you really intended to terminate or not? That's the reason this is available. And monitoring. So monitoring CloudWatch logs is used to monitor the CPU utilizations, disk utilizations, and memory by default you will be not able to utilize, but you can also enable that memory utilizations. See, by default, 5 minutes of the monitoring will be enabled for your EC2 machines through CloudWatch logs. But if you want to enable detailed monitoring, right? If you enable this option, every 1 minute the logs will be monitored. So because 5 minutes is a huge time, right? Suppose if you want to identify spikes in your database server and all, so then, you know, it will be difficult. So that's why if you enable this option, 1 minute detailed monitoring will be there, but there are some charges for that. So let me not take that. Under tenancy, so we have seen in the placement groups where to place the machines, how to place the machines, in what model we need to place the machines, like cluster, spread, and partition. Why we are doing that? We are doing that for a better throughput and reduce the latency and network, improve the network performance, right? So tenancy is also a similar concept, but how it is like? For example, when you say shared tenancy here, let me complete this tenancy, then we will see. We'll complete up to files T2 unlimited. So these three are very simple. So then we will continue the others in next class. So tenancy, we have three things. One is shared, one is dedicated, and dedicated host. In shared, what exactly happens is, say for example, you have your database here, right? Your data center here. So when you say shared tenancy, any customer can come and create here. So for example, red color one is HDFC, and let's say green color one, I am going to create ICICI. ICICI customer will launch EC2 machine in his. Of course, VPC will differentiate between EC2 machines, but it is not guaranteed that in this network host box, it is not guaranteed that you will be only created for the machines. Multiple customers can come and create here. So, for example, HDFC is there, then ICICI is there. Like this, multiple customers will come and create here. So that is shared tenancy. And when you say dedicated, you can run it. Okay, so I have a PPT for this. So easy to tenancy models. Yeah. So in shared tenancy, you are aware of the EC2 basic architecture, right? So what exactly happens in shared tenancy is, so you have your EC2 virtual machines, right? So let us assume this is as host H101, means this is one host inside a server, inside a rack, one host is there. So CPU, RAMs, and instance stores are fine, which is aware. So you launch instance, I201 instance is generated. Now, what exactly happens when you stop the instance? So when you stop the instance, this I201 will be not there, but still your user data will be there somewhere in your storage here, either EBS or IOPS, or that's different thing. So then whenever you start again, so from stop, you will start the EC2 machine again. It's not guaranteed that only again you will be launched with this here only. Either you can launch here or you can launch here as well. So that is what happening in shared one. Means whenever you stop the instance, the hardware is given to another customer, it might be given for you also. So it's not guaranteed, this in a shared tenancy model. But what exactly happens in dedicated instance and dedicated host? Dedicated instance, yes, you have H105 host mission. So when you stop the instance and when you start the instance, you will still, the host will be changed, but the instance will be available here. So for example, so let us assume, let us assume another customer is coming, which is a Canara Bank customer. So he'll come and launch an instance. So this instance also will be there in the same availability zone and within the same physical server. But when you stop and start the instance, this instance will be there for you only, but the host might change. So that's what exactly happened dedicated instance. Dedicated host means this complete box, whatever this box is there, right? This will be given only to you. So there will be, there will be a very strong use case to use the dedicated host because it is too costly. And whereas dedicated instances and shared instances only will be, most of the time you'll be working with shared instance. Very few times you'll work with dedicated instance. The use cases for dedicated instances are like you need high secured ones, same hardware you don't want to share with a different customer. You want the same hardware only for you, that time you'll go for dedicated instance. Dedicated host means the complete host is yours. Either you stop and start, same host will be there, same instance will be there. Okay. So in dedicated instance, when you stop and start, host will change, but you can get the instance of the same one. But you are only the customer here. No other customer can enter here. Whereas in shared one, multiple customers can go and hit the same server. That's the difference between shared dedicated instance and dedicated host. So you can select the option here. So this additional charges will apply for this one. And when you select shared one, it's no additional charges will be there. And elastic interface accelerators, we'll discuss about when you're discussing about network interfaces. T2 and T3 unlimited is there here. So this is what is. There are some bursts happen. So for example, you launch a T2 or T3 models, instance types, right? So you all of a sudden, your database performance is going up. So let's assume from morning till 1 o'clock, it is active or it is like this. All of a sudden at 1 o'clock, due to some activity, your activity or performance of the CPU or memory is increased like this. Then the instance, say, let us assume the instance threshold is this one. You should not break out here, right? So in order to do that, T2 and T3, if you enable this one, they will try to withstand this capacity for some time and they will allow you not to break out the system and continue. They will charge some for this if you enable this option, okay? So remaining network interfaces, we will discuss tomorrow and other EC2 concepts. Any questions till now for today?
Harish, just a quick one. Is the host a dedicated host or dedicated VPC as well?
No. Dedicated host, when you select dedicated host, right, this host will be inside your VPC. You are selecting your VPC here, right? Okay. So it will be inside this VPC. See, one customer can have many VPCs. When you select August 1st VPC, these are batch. So when you're selecting inside this VPC, the host will be created inside that particular VPC. Yeah. EC2, this is it might look like a theory concept, but these topics are a bit important because you will see, you will regularly face this type of questions, okay? So tomorrow we'll see remaining topics like network interfaces. We can add multiple network interfaces here. So what is the need for that? Why we need to add? And we can write advanced shell script here. So they provided a shell script option for the user data to fill here, because if you write some shell script here and click, when you launch the instance, the script will be executed automatically. So then we'll see. Storage is there. If you complete all the EC2 options by discussing tomorrow, we'll start on storage, EBS, GP2 and IO1 storages as well. Okay. Then tags will also, it's small topic only. Then that's all. Security groups, we already know. We already discussed about security groups. Preview and launch. So let me launch this mission. dedicated host name ID. Okay, so I have selected that option. So questions? See, make sure you try to launch Windows machine as well, so that you'll get some experience to launch Windows EC2 as well. So try with T2 Micro only, free tier one, because you can wait for some time, right?
Harish. Yep. Is there any option that with the instance, when we launch the instance, is there any option there to just terminate that instance after some time on its own?
Yeah, you can select some SNS notifications, events and all. We will see that. We'll see in CloudWatch. So for example, now my machine is already running. So if I want to terminate this one, if I go to instance state and terminate, I'll be not able to delete this one. Why? Because I have selected this instance for termination protection, right? So I cannot terminate this one. So in order to do this one, so I need to go here, instance settings, remove, change termination protection. I need to disable this one first. Then if I try to terminate the instance, I can terminate the instance. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So any questions?